Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Good morning, viewers. As you know, this person is not, you know, is not new to you. My name is Abdurrahman Ibrahim. I am an IRE teacher. And the past weeks, we have been learning that topic of Form 4, devotional acts. And we finished it. Alhamdulillah, we finished it. Today we'll be looking at a new topic, Mu'amalat. Mu'amalat. And Mu'amalat, if you look at it in Arabic, is just relationship. Mu'amala is relationship between people of different kinds. Between Muslims, relationship between Muslims themselves, Muslims themselves, and also non-Muslims. That's why under the topic Form 4, IRE, Form 4. In this topic of Mu'amalat Form 4, today I want to look at two things. I'll be looking at, or I'll be teaching, relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. That's the first topic of subtopic of Mu'amalat in IRE. Relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. After this, I will also look at, this is the first subtopic. The second subtopic of Mu'amalat, which I'll be looking at after this, or which I'll be teaching, is status of women in Islam. Status of women in Islam. But first and foremost, let me look at relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. First, we should understand that all human beings, all humanity came from the same place. They originated from one single father and mother. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in different verses of the Quran. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Yuhannas, O people, Inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. I created you from single male and female. I created you from single male and female. Waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabail. After that, I made you into tribes and nations. What is the main purpose? So that you know one another. That is it. So in that surah, Surah Al-Hujurat, in that verse, Allah says, I created all humanity, all human beings, from the single mother and a single father, from single male and female. That is Adam and Hawa. Adam and Hawa. So all these people you are seeing of different colors, different faith, different practices, all of them came from same, you know, same single mother and father. If you read Surah An-Nisa, beginning of Surah An-Nisa, the first verse, Ya Ayyuhannas, ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida, wa khalaqa minha zawjaha, wa batha minhuma rijalan kathira wa nisaa. The same verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Fear Allah, Ya Ayyuhannas, O people, ittaqu rabbakum, fear you alone, alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida, the one who created you from single soul. Which single soul? From Adam. So all humanity came, originated from the same place. And if you look at the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said about humanity, especially in his farewell speech, he said, Kullukum min Adam wa Adam min Turab. All of you, be it Muslim, be it non-Muslim, be it black, be it, you know, another color, different races, different faith. Kullukum min Adam, all of you are from Adam, and Adam in Turab, and Adam is from dust. So nobody is from somewhere else. After knowing that, then what should a Muslim do towards people of other faith? Relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. A Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, chose this religion of Islam as the religion of the entire world. This religion of Islam is not for a particular tribe. It's not for an Arab. Neither is it for an African. Neither is it for a European. It is a religion of the entire society. Allah says, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam dina. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. Today I have completed for your religion. I have perfected for your religion. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. I have completed your religion upon you. Wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati. And I have perfected my favors upon you. Wa raditu lakum al-islam dina. And I chose Islam as your religion. So Islam is a religion Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for the humanity. Whoever takes it after being told, alhamdulillah. Whoever does not take it, then he will be responsible before his Lord. So what are the relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims? Since Muslims should show good examples to the others through good words, through good character, then they are supposed to show, you know, good characteristics toward, you know, non-Muslims. They should show good akhlaq. They should show good manners towards other people of other faith. What is the importance of that? Why do Muslims show good character to the other Muslims? One of the main reasons as to why Muslims should show good manners, akhlaq, good, you know, character traits, good qualities, good mu'amalat, good relationship with non-Muslims. One of the main reasons is that to attract them to other religion, to attract them to Islam, sorry, to attract them to Islam. Look at what our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do. Look what our Prophet, peace be upon him, used to do. For example, it is narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to persevere all the problems he received from non-Muslims. Not because he was weak, but just to show them mercy, to show them good character, so that they will come into the religion. For example, it is shown, it is narrated, you know, during the early days of Islam, one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met a very old mother, a very old granny, a very old mother, carrying firewood. He helped her to carry the firewood. The old woman was very surprised with, you know, the mercy and kindness and generosity of this young man. And then she tried to advise him. She told him, it seems you are a very good young man. Please, there's a man by the name Muhammad. Please watch out against that man. That man is misleading people. Please, since you are a good man, be far away from him. The Prophet ﷺ never said anything to her. He kept quiet, just smiling and taking her, you know, helping her till when they reach, you know, where she was supposed to go. By the time he put the firewood on the floor, he told her, you know what? The man they were saying is a bad man. Muhammad they are talking about is me. The man, the woman was amazed. The woman was surprised that whatever they are saying against Muhammad, Muhammad is this man who is helping an old woman. And because of that, she professed the Islamic faith. She converted to Islam. Why? Because of the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, many parts of where Islam is today, in parts of Africa, part of Asia, part of other places, Islam reached, and the non-Muslims who were there converted to Islam because of good qualities of the Muslims, because of husnul khuluq of the Muslims. For example, in East Africa, Islam reached through some Muslim traders from Arabia. Did they force any person to become Muslim? No. Because of their good qualities, because of their good husnul khuluq, because of their good manners, the non-Muslims professed this Islamic faith. Therefore, one good thing a Muslim is supposed to do is show good characteristics toward the non-Muslims. In fact, he should be merciful. A Muslim should be merciful. A Muslim should be kind. A Muslim should have good husnul khuluq toward people of other faith. If you want people to come to Islam, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will, then do your part. So a Muslim should have good character towards non-Muslim. That's one. Second, a Muslim should look into the right of other faith and their practices. A Muslim should respect the right of other faiths. Other faiths and their practices. A Muslim should respect other religion. A Muslim should not force anybody to become Muslim. Because that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran. That is how Islam should be. That is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Look at this verse in Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah talking about not forcing people to become Muslims. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها. Allah says, لا إكراه في الدين. There's no compulsion in religion. There's no forcing somebody to become Muslim. No compulsion in religion. If Allah is saying that, then who are you? No compulsion. There's no, anybody, any Muslim has no right to force other person to become Muslim. No. La ikrah fi din. So, and Islam has a sole authority to respect other people's faith. The only thing they can do is just to convey the message in a very kind and a generous way, in a very understanding way, without being harsh. If other people will take it, Alhamdulillah, we say thank to Allah. If they don't take it, then as we have conveyed a message, but no forcing, no compulsion in religion. La ikraha fi din, there's no compulsion in religion. As far as the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that entails the rights of other faith and their practices, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina and he established the first Muslim government in Medina, did he force anybody to become Muslim? The Jews, the three Jewish tribes that lived in Medina, the three of them, Banu Nadir, Banu Qaynuqa, Qaynuqa, and Banu Qurayza. These three Jewish tribes that lived in Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came to Medina, he met them. Is there anywhere mentioned in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he forced these three Jewish tribes to become Muslim? No. No. In fact, the most surprising thing, the most amazing thing is that he told them, Allahu Akbar, he told them, you have the freedom to worship your, you know, whatever you are worshiping, to practice their faith without any compulsion. So he gave the Jews of Medina to worship and to practice their religion without being forced. That is one instance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowing the Jews in Medina to practice their faith. Other things about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as far as his tradition and his life is concerned, there were some Christians from Najran. Some Christians from Najran visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. Some Christians from Najran visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. He welcomed them with an open hand. He allowed them, he gave them a place to worship while they are Christians. They stayed with him for a long time, for a period of time, till with their own decision, they went back to their place. So this is another very important, you know, occasion when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, respected people of other faith. And we are to follow the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if you want to be good Muslims. Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Allah says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ, if you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, follow me, يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهِ, I love you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam respected people of other faith. I give you a case example of the Jews in Medina, and I also give you the Christians from Najran who visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So respecting the right of other faith and their practices, and respecting their religion is very, very important in Islam. Another relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims is, as far as Muslim is concerned, refraining from insulting other faiths. Do not insult their faith. Muslims are not allowed to insult people of other faith. It is haram. Why? If you insult what people worship, be it idols, be it whatever it is, you don't have any authority. You don't have any power as a Muslim. You don't have any permission from God to insult their religion. Why? If you insult the religion, then yours will be insulted. If you insult the idols, they will insult God. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran in Surah Al-An'am, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهِ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Allah says, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Do not insult those. Do not insult. وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Do not insult those who worship other things beside God. Do not insult their idols. Do not insult whatever they worship. If you do that, then فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهِ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. They will insult Allah. So, you brought problem bigger than whatever you are expecting. You insulted idols, then God Almighty will be insulted. Because of that, then Muslims are to refrain from insulting people of other faith. You are not allowed to insult other people's faith. Rather, respect them and do all the possible means to attract people to other faith with good manners. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, one of the most important personalities in Islam, says, be da'is, be people who convey the message of Allah while you are silent, without talking. He was asked, how is that possible? He said, because of your good manners. Show good manners to Islam, then you will be, you know, conveying Islam with your good manners. So, refraining from insulting other faith. Do not stay away from insulting other people's faith. No, that is not allowed. By the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we mentioned in Surah Al-An'am, وَلَا تَصُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَصُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Another relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. Muslims are not supposed to argue the people of other faith. Muslims are not supposed to argue with. Muslims are not supposed to argue with people of other faith. Except for a good and just cause. Except for a good cause. Except for a just cause. You are not allowed just to argue with them because of argue. No. No. Don't argue with them except for a just cause. If you argue with them, your intention is just to make them understand the religion and then be idhnillah by the virtue of Allah, then they will, you know, convert to Islam. That should be the main intention. But if your intention is just to argue with them, talking about some irrelevant things, then that argument is baseless. That debate is baseless. Today, you know, the most, you know, heartening things, the most sad thing is that when Muslims are arguing with non-Muslims, they tend to insult their faith. The debates I see around the world, except few, I'm very sorry for that, but that should not happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rejects that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, warn the Muslims in not doing that. If you are having a debate with a non-Muslim, you should be respectful towards their faith. You should address them with kind words, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nahl and Surah Al-Ankabut. Look at this verse in Surah An-Nahl. Udu'u ila sabili rabbik bil-hikmati wal-maw'idati al-hasan wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan. Allah says, udu'u ila sabili rabbik. Call people the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards the path of Allah, bil hikmati, with wisdom, not a mere argument, with wisdom, wal maw'idati al hasana, wajadilhum billati, argue with them, hiya ahsan, the best of it, argue with them with the best argument, have a debate with them, a good argument, not an argument that entails irrelevant, you know, arguments. It's not allowed. You should argue with them in a good way. You should argue with them with a good way. That's how it is. So when you argue with them, argue with them in the best way. The main intention is to attract them toward Islam. If you look at that verse in Surah Al-Ankabut, وَلَا تُجَادِلُوا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Allah says, do not argue with the people of the book. Do not argue with the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians, except for a good cause. إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Except for a good cause. Allahu Akbar. This is a clear example of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that how the argument with non-Muslims should be. وَلَا تُجَادِلُوا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. Except the one who wronged themselves. Except those who wronged themselves. Except those who are talking bad things about Islam. Those who still try to make them understand. If they persist in their bad things, in their wrongful words against Islam, then you have a step to do. But generally, a Muslim is not allowed to have, you know, a wrong argument with a non-Muslim. What do you say? وَقُولُوا آمَنَّا بِالَّذِي أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا وَأُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ وَإِلَهُنَا وَإِلَهُكُمْ وَاحِدٌ وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ. Tell them, وَقُولُوا آمَنَّا بِالَّذِي, we believed, آمَنَّا بِالَّذِي أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا, we believed whatever that was revealed to us, that's the Quran. وَأُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ, and you people of the book, whatever that was revealed to you, the correct scriptures, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you, we also believe. We believe in the Torah, we believe in the Injil, we believe in the Zabur, we believe in all holy scriptures that came from Allah. وَإِلَهُنَا, our Lord, our God, إِلَهُكُمْ وَاحَدْ, is one God. You are God, O people of the book, and our God is just one God. Only that, there are some misconceptions beyond this. Only that, some of the people, you know, misunderstood the issue of monotheism, the issue of Tawheed. But there's only one God, Almighty, the only one. وَإِلَهُنَا وَإِلَهُكُمْ وَاحِدٌ. Tell them like that you are God and our God is one. وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ, and we are Muslims who submit themselves, who surrender themselves to Islam. So these are some of the relationships that is summarized that a Muslim should look into. Having good qualities toward the non-Muslims, having good characteristics, having husnul khuluq toward the Muslims, respecting their faith and giving them, you know, the permission to practice their religion without being disturbed. Not insulting their faith and not arguing with them except for a just cause. So, in summarized form, this is the relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. Next, as I said, I want to look at the status of women in Islam. Status of women in Islam. As far as women in Islam is concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given women. Islam has given women a very wonderful position that no any other religion has given. Only that, enemies of Islam misunderstood the concept and then interpreted in a wrong way. But if you read the Quran, if you read the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you will understand that women play a very big role as far as, you know, Islam is concerned. First, according to Islam, women are counterparts of men. Women are counterparts of men. In fact, look at this. When Allah created Adam, did He create him alone and left him like that? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and then created his wife, his companion beside Adam. That is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Adam in the Quran, Hawa is there always. And that's how Islam should be. Look at Allah, the verses we read. Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. Min dhakar is Adam. We created you from single male and a female. Allah never left Hawa, our mother. No. Allah said, we created you from single male Adam and female Hawa. The one in Surah Al-Hujurat, Ya Ayyuhan Nas, that is Surah Al-Hujurat. The one in Surah Al-Nisa, Ya Ayyuhan Nas, uttaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidah wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathir. So, women are counterparts of men. They go, if man is mentioned, woman is there. Because there's no way a man can exist without a woman. Neither is there any way a woman can exist without a mother, without a man. So they go together. They are counterparts. Only that, there are few exceptions. There are few limited secondary regulations where women, you know, have their role and men have their role. Women have their responsibilities sometimes, and even men. There are very few, you know, limited secondary regulations that is drawn between the two sexes. Otherwise, women are counterparts of men. For example, as far as religious obligation is concerned, they do the same. Whatever male does, female does. For example, a man pray 5 daily prayers and the sunnah. Woman pray the 5 daily prayers. Woman pray. Male prays the fasting during Ramadan. The man prays. A woman, if she has wealth, she's supposed to pay zakah. A man in the same case. A man is supposed to go to Hajj. A woman is supposed to Hajj. So as far as religious obligation is concerned, then there is no biasness. Na'udhu billah, there is no biasness in Islam. Because Allah is just, there is no way Allah will say man should be given, you know, more good things than woman. Far from it. Because if you look at the religious obligations, a Muslim is supposed to observe. Man observes equally a woman observes. So as far as the religious obligations are concerned, they do the same. That is one. So one, women are counterparts of men. And I said, when a man is mentioned, a woman is mentioned in the Quran. And whatever they do, as far as ibadats of Allah, as far as worship of Allah is concerned, equally, they are the same. Second thing, they have equal rewards. This one is religious obligation. What about the rewards? Do we have specific rewards for men, more than women? Far from it, no. Both of them have equal rewards. If a man prays 5 daily prayer, he will get equal reward as the one the woman will get. If a woman performs a prayer in the right way, the reward she gets will be the same as that of a man. Equal rewards. If you look at the Quran, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Man amila salihan. Look at this. Man amila salihan, Surah An-Nahl, Min dhakarin aw untha wa huwa mu'min. Falanuhiyyannahu hayatan tayyiban. Allah says, Man amila salihan. Whoever does a good deed, Min dhakarin, be it a man, male, wa untha or female, فَلَنُحِيَّنَّهُ وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ While he is a believer, he or she is a believer, فَلَنُحِيَّنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا Then he will live a good life. We will make him to live a good life in this world here. Did Allah say male only? Did Allah say a man only? No. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا Whoever does a good deed, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ Whoever does a good deed, whoever does good deeds, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ Be it a man, وَأُنْثَى Be it a woman, be it male or female, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they will live a good life. Equal rewards. Not only that, look at the long verse in Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah said, Inna al-Muslimin, indeed, Muslim men, wal-Muslimati, female Muslims, wal-Mu'mineen, male believers, wal-Mu'minat, female believers, والقانتين the obedient male Muslims. والقارتات female obedient women who are obedient who are Muslims. والصادقين the truthful male. والصادقات the truthful female. والصابرين the Muslims male who are patient. والصابرات female who are patient. والصائمين the Muslims the male Muslims who fast. والصائمات female Muslims who fast. والخاشعين those who are humble towards their God. Male both male and female. الخاشعات والمتصدقين those who give out charity male. والمتصدقات those who give out charity female. والحافظين فروجهم those who refrain from فاحشة زنا those who forbid themselves from engaging zina both male and female. At the end both male and female أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. Allah has prepared for them a magnificent rewards. Allah has prepared for them huge rewards both male and female. So as far as Islam is concerned, as far as the Quran is concerned, as far as the tradition of the Prophet is concerned, then women have equal rewards that of men. That is two. Three, as far as attending congregation prayer is concerned, as far as attending congregational prayers is concerned, there's no also biasness. Allahu Akbar. Women are allowed to perform congregational prayer. Women are allowed to perform jama'ah prayer. In fact, during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Aisha radiallahu anha reports that they used to come and perform their prayers in the mosques. Even Salatul Fajr, early in the morning, women used to come and perform congregational prayer alongside with men in the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they are allowed to perform. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in authentic hadith, do not prevent the slaves of Allah, do not prevent the sincere slaves of Allah, that the sincere slaves of Allah, that is here the slaves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying do not prevent women, Muslim women, from attending, you know, their congregational prayer in the mosque. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has forbidden that. Therefore, women have all the capacities to perform their congregational prayers in mosques. Jama'ah, including also Jum'ah, and Jum'ah also, Salatul Jum'ah, they have also the free will, they have their choices to perform. During Eid prayers, even they are allowed. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, even those with haid can come and listen to the khutbah, listen to the preachings of, you know, the Muslims during Eid prayers. So, attending congregational prayers, women are allowed, equally as men. As far as coming to Jum'ah, Salatul Jum'ah, and attending the congregational prayer of Jum'ah, allowed for women. Eid, allowed for women. So, women are not exceptional as far as this Jama'at is concerned, and to get reward from Allah alongside with me. There's no way. There's no way. Islam says it is only men who are allowed to perform congregational prayer and get this good reward. No. In fact, the hadith I read is as authentic as anything else. And therefore, they are allowed to perform congregational prayer. So this is another status of women in Islam. Four. Another status of women in Islam is that women have the freedom to give their personal views. They have the capacity to give their personal views. They have the freedom to give their personal views. In fact, it is not only men who are supposed to give their views when an advice is needed somewhere in Islam. No. Women equally can give. Look at the tradition of the Prophet, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for example, in the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. During the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, during the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sahabas were going to Mecca to perform an obligation as far as Hajj is concerned. They were stopped from it. They were carrying animals. They were carrying hadiyas to sacrifice there in Mecca. It could not happen because of the Quraysh who stopped the Muslims from performing that ibadah. Therefore, eventually, after the agreement happened, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah happened between the Muslims and the pagan Quraysh of Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed, instructed the Muslims to go back from Hudaybiyah and sacrifice the animals they had, assuming that they have performed, with the intention that since they were stopped, with the intention that they have performed, and inshallah Allah give them reward because they could not go there, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed the Sahabas and instructed the Sahabas to sacrifice the animals. It is as if the Sahabas were reluctant to do that because they were very unhappy of them being stopped going to Mecca. So they were unhappy, they were reluctant to sacrifice the animals. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very unhappy. It's as if the Sahabas are disobeyed, but not that, only that they were unhappy. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to one of his wife who was with him at that time. She was called Umm Salama. Then he consulted, look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He consulted his wife Umm Salama of what he will do. Since the Sahabas are reluctant to sacrifice the animals, since the Sahabas are reluctant to sacrifice the hadiyah, what did she say? Look at the wonderful advice she gave. She said, O Prophet of Allah, start with yours first. Slaughter your animal first. I'm sure if you do that, all of them will do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did exactly as per the advice of Umm Salama. By the time he slaughtered the animal, all the Sahabas rushed to slaughter their animals. They sacrificed the animals. Who gave that wonderful view? Who gave that wonderful advice? It is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, radiallahu anha, Umm Salama. So, women in Islam have the capacity to give their advice and their views. And they can even give very wonderful views and very wonderful advice than some of the men. So Islam gave them this very wonderful, very wonderful right as far as Islam is concerned. Another status of women in Islam is that women in Islam have the choice, have the freedom to different choices. For example, they have the freedom to choose their spouses. Their spouses. They have the freedom to reject their suitors. They have the freedom to ask for divorce. All these are the freedom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to woman. So they have different freedom. They have different freedom. It's not like us. It's not what some enemies of Islam, claim that Muslims in Islam are slaves. Na'udhu billah. They don't have any rights. Those are propagandas. Those are wrong things that, some enemies of Islam claim. But the fact is that women have the freedom to choose. In fact, a marriage in Islam cannot be a right marriage without giving the woman the choice to accept her spouse or to reject. Yes. In fact, one of the conditions is that. Therefore, they have the freedom to choose their spouses, to reject their suitors. They can say, I'm no longer interested in him. If divorce becomes, divorce must come, and all other machinery of divorce are exhausted, and divorce has to come, especially a woman has a right to ask for divorce. she has to say this marriage can no longer go on. Therefore, she has the right to ask for divorce. Therefore, she has the freedom to choose whatever that is good for her. These are some of the, you know, some of the status of women in Islam. Women in Islam have the rights, you know, to engage in business. They have the right to engage in business and commerce. They have the right to engage in business and commerce. They have the right to engage in business and commerce. How? Look at how many Muslim women in the world today are engaging in halal business. Have you ever seen any person saying this one is haram for women? No. No, this is not. They have the right to engage in business and commerce. For example, there's this woman who was called Qayla. Qayla was a businesswoman. She was a merchant lady. Qayla, she was a woman, a Muslim woman who was a merchant lady. One of her statements was, she said, I am a woman who buys and sells. She says, I am a woman who buys and sells. So, Muslim women have the right to engage in business and commerce. Muslim women have the right to engage in business and commerce. Other right, status of women in society is that women have the capacity to take part in jihad. Have the capacity to take part in jihad if it becomes necessary. If it becomes necessary. During the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, women used to take part in jihad. They used to give water to the Muslim mujahideen. They used to nurse and to treat the Muslims who are wounded in jihad. In fact, if you don't know, there were even some Muslims who used to take part in physical fight. For example, there is this woman during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam who was called Ummu Amara. Ummu Amara was a fighter, Muslim fighter. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, with the Battle of Uhud, she took part fully in the war, in that Battle of Uhud. So if, you know, circumstance forces, then they can even take part in that jihad. Especially in nursing the, you know, the Muslims who are wounded, in giving, you know, water and food to the mujahideen. So these are some and others of the status of women in Islam. We say women are counterparts of men to the extent that if man is mentioned in the Quran, a woman is mentioned alongside him. Issues of ibadats, they get, you know, everyone is supposed to perform. If a woman is supposed to perform, a man is supposed to perform. If a man is supposed to perform 5 daily prayer, equally a woman does. Two, equal rewards. They have equal rewards as far as, you know, as far as jaza from God is concerned. If a man is supposed to get that reward, a woman is supposed to get that reward. Attending congregational prayer, equal for men and women. Freedom to give their personal views. For example, the one I gave during the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, freedom to choose their spouses, reject their suitors, ask for divorce. Right in business and commerce, I mentioned a special case of this woman who was called Qayla, and also taking part in jihad if it is necessary. So these are some of the status of women and some others, inshallah, which we'll look at. The other things which I started with was, in this topic of mu'amalat, was the relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims. I looked at it. I will stop there. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta subhanak. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Thank you very much for taking part. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.